Hey everyone, this is May and welcome to another edition of the May Lee Show. I'm glad you could join me via podcast or on the YouTube channel, The May Lee Show. Hope everyone is doing okay. I'm doing all right. I'm hanging in there. I'm doing a lot of paddleboarding lately because I finally bought myself a paddleboard, which is so amazing, actually. And the reason it's so good for me is because I was told by a Korean reader several years ago that each person is made up of five pillars of different elements, you know, fire, water, metal, things like that. Well, apparently, usually a person is a combination of different elements. And he told me that all five of my pillars are all fire. Every single one. I'm literally on fire. So I need water in my life. So whenever I go to the water, I'm near the water, or definitely when I'm in the water, on the water, I feel so different. I feel revived and rejuvenated. So now that I'm paddleboarding a lot on a regular basis, it's making me feel so much more relaxed. It's getting rid of my anxiety, and it's just relieving a lot of my stress. So I definitely am feeling better sort of physically and psychologically that way. Anyway, just thought I'd share that. So today's episode, I have a really special guest. This is somebody I have known about, you know, from afar for many, many years because she is well-known actress. But I just recently met her through Benny Luo, who is my partner, founder of Neck Shark, because he was on her Instagram Live recently where they were chatting about the Chinese Exclusion Act. But anyway, so I learned that she was a follower of the May Lee Show, and I was like, God, I want to get her on the show. So it's Kelly Hu who's going to be on the show. She, of course, is an actress who started off her career 30 years ago in the 80s. She was first Miss Teen USA, and she was the first Asian American Miss Teen USA. And then she went on to become Miss Hawaii USA. And then, of course, she started her acting career. She's been in many television shows starting way back to Growing Pains. I think that was one of her first television acting gigs. And then she's gone on to do several other TV shows as well as movies like Scorpion King, Cradle to the Grave. And she continues to do other kinds of work as well, like voiceover work for video games, which is kind of cool. But anyway, I wanted to get her on the show because I've been a fan of hers, but she's also somebody who's very involved in the Asian American community. And I just wanted to talk to her about all sorts of things. And so she is joining me now, of course, from home, somewhere in LA. Hey, Kelly, welcome to the May Lee Show. So good to see you.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited about this.
Yeah, no.
I'm such a big fan of yours.
You're so sweet to say that. You know,
you are such a badass. I hope you don't take that badly because I consider that like the highest compliment.
You just took the words totally out of my mouth because when somebody calls me a badass, I think that is the best thing that someone could say to me. Seriously.
Right?
It makes me feel like, you know, I have superpowers or something, you know, right? as a woman, especially.
As an Asian woman, especially, because we're always thought to be so like, you know, submissive or quiet or whatever. And it is really empowering.
I love it.
I absolutely agree.
I love it. You know what? And I intentionally wore, I don't know if you can see, it's kind of too sparkly, but this says, it has fear and then
no
it crosses
fear.
It out.
Oh. I love it.
So I guess that's the perfect shirt to be wearing right now.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, Kelly, I think you're a badass too. And you're also a pioneer, you know? I mean, you've definitely had this stellar career as an actress and representing Asian and Asian culture and, you know, just being that representative at a time when that wasn't happening, you know, that often back in the 80s, right?
Yeah, well, you know, I wasn't trying to be any kind of, you know, trailblazer or whatever. Yeah. I was just trying to work.
Right.
And it just so happened that when I started in this business over 30 years ago, there just were not a lot of female Asian actors or roles even. But I just knew that I wanted to be an actor. And I came to Los Angeles right after high school, and I just started pounding the pavement and having a great time, really. I was not even trying to be like a serious actor. I just wanted to like make enough money to have a great life, to have fun. And so I did a lot of like commercials and modeling. I was like, I think one of the first regular gigs I got was on the JCPenney Home Shopping Network.
Oh, wait, JCPenney had a home shopping network?
Yeah, right?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I paid my bills for like 5 years, I think.
Really?
You know, doing that. Yeah.
Okay. Because I mentioned in the intro that you were Miss Teen USA, right? And you were the first Asian Teen USA.
When I was 16, I ran in this pageant. Not because I was into pageants or anything.
Yeah.
It was my very first pageant. But I wanted to model in Japan.
Right.
During the 80s, you know, I grew up in Hawaii, and all the Japanese were coming to Hawaii, and the hapa look was in, right? The mixed, the half Asian, half Caucasian look. That's what we call hapa in Hawaii. Yeah. So the hapa look was really in Japan, and there was so much money to be made there. They were thriving there.
Mm.
I guess there was so much money to be made everywhere in the 80s. So you know, girls were going over for the summer, and they were making like $20,000.
Wow.
You know, in the summer, and putting down payments on homes when they came back. And
I want that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I grew up with a single mom who was struggling to get by, you know, just to make ends meet, who never had less than three jobs. So for me, that was like, you know, huge, right?
Yeah.
So I ran in a pageant because I was told that if I got a title, then they could promote me better in Japan.
Right.
So it really had nothing to do with me wanting to be a Miss anything.
Right.
It was really so that I could make money in Japan.
So it was very practical, pragmatic.
Always.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. But in the course, I had to actually learn how to, you know, be this pageant girl. Mm. I won the Hawaii pageant. You know, it wasn't too hard. It was like, you know, I think 9 girls or something in the pageant.
Okay.
A lot of girls could not even like complete a sentence. So going to the national pageant was just like an obligation that I had to fulfill before I got to go to Japan over the summer to do, you know, my contract there. And so I went to the national pageant not thinking that I was ever going to have the chance of winning.
And you did.
And I did.
Yeah.
And I did. But not because I was trying to win, only because I was trying to not make an ass out of myself. My really big goal was just like to not fall down on stage in front of like a live national, audience or international audience.
Yeah.
Back then, you know, I think they thought there were like 50 million viewers who would watch live. And
right.
These pageants in the 80s were huge.
They were huge, of course.
Yeah.
So it was an achievement, right? Even though you're saying you weren't setting out to win, you did, which was a big deal.
I did, but it wasn't as though I was trying to do it. It was really just sort of by chance, you know, and so much luck was involved. I mean, it was really not my own doing. I mean, I prepared as best as I could.
Right.
You know, my mom even hired like a pageant coach because she's like, if you're going to be on TV, like, you need to be able to know what you're doing.
Right.
So she hired somebody like, and this is a mom who was like struggling with three jobs.
I know.
You know, like she always made sure that, you know, she scraped pennies. She never bought clothes for herself for like decades.
Wow.
But she wanted to make sure that I had classes and I was able to, you know, to sort of fulfill myself, you know, in dancing and performing and things like that. So she was like, okay, you're going to be representing us. Like, you better know what you're doing.
Yeah, we can't lose face because of you. But no, that's such a typical sort of Asian immigrant story in many ways, in terms of sacrificing so much for their children. Right.
Yeah. Even though my mom is not an immigrant, because we were, because we're from Hawaii.
Yeah.
And
right.
Especially on my mom's side, you know, the Hawaiian goes back all the way from like my mother's 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 mother.
So
we were there before, you know, the colonialists.
Yeah. Okay.
So, I mean, it was a different story, but just, you know, I think that kind of mentality just sort of passes down through generation anyway,
sure.
Right?
Yeah.
That sort of, you know, sacrificing in your generation so that the next generation can have a better life.
Right. Exactly. Which it sounds like your mom did for you, for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But going back to being a pioneer, I mean, you know, when I was doing the research on you, I realized I had no idea that we're similar in age.
Oh, really?
Yes, by 2 years.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So we are definitely of the same kind of, you know, generation.
Yes.
And for you to be a pioneer in your field, I too was one of very few Asian journalists on television, kind of climbing up the ladder. And
yes.
So there was, you know, there was a lot of unknown for me as well in terms of what am I doing? And I didn't even look at myself as a pioneer or representative of, you know, Asians.
You just wanted
in media.
To do the work, right?
I just wanted to do the work, but then it just so happened, you know, of course, upon self-reflection and like looking back, I'm like, oh yeah, I guess I was one of a very few. And maybe I did
doesn't
make a
that
difference.
Make you feel old though, when like young journalists come up to you and you're like, you're such a trailblazer.
Oh my God. Wait, Kelly, it's very funny you should say that right now, because in the last, seriously, only like 3 days, I have gotten messages or posts on Instagram from younger people going, gosh, it's so great when an old person speaks out like that. I'm like, what? Old person.
It's like, okay, put on your shoes. Let's go for a run.
Oh my God. I seriously. And then another person said older or like what? And I was just like, oh my God, this is what's happening.
Yeah.
I mean, I have to accept it, but it's kind of a shock when you finally start hearing it.
When you cross that line, right? Mm. When you didn't even realize that you've crossed that threshold and now you're like the older person.
Yeah.
And I kind of realized that was going on during this quarantine because friends would start delivering food to me. Wait a minute.
Yeah. Isn't that, it's kind of like, it's a little bit of a shock, I have to say, you know, I intellectually, of course I know that I'm old enough to be a lot of people's mothers, you know, but still it's just like when you hear it and that when you hear it from them and that's how they look at you, you're like, oh, wow.
Right. Because you don't have kids either, right?
No.
So we don't have that sort of measuring stick, right?
No.
To see our age, because we just always feel like, you know, when we were in our 20s and 30s.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And by the way, you look amazing. So, you know, the Asian
I've done a
don't
lot with the lighting in here.
No, I know,
me.
But the Asian don't raise it, you know, the beige don't age kind of thing. You know, it's still kind of working for us. But anyway, but yeah, you know, I think it is about, you know, the path that we did carve out. Right. And I did resist that for a while thinking, no, I'm not that person. But now I do realize that there is a bit of a responsibility to be able to continue guiding, you know, the younger generation and to be somewhat of an example. You know, and I know for you too, that's become more important because I know you're involved in, you know, different organizations and supporting Asian organizations and causes, things like that, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. When I first moved, you know, after winning the pageant sort of opened my eyes to the fact that there was a lack of Asian people on screen.
Right.
Because I grew up in Hawaii, you know, we're the majority there.
Right.
So I never really felt like a minority. I never grew up, you know, feeling repressed in any way. And so it wasn't until I ran in the pageant and then people were, you know, like calling me or coming up to me at, you know, events and things and thanking me and, you know, saying how proud they were, you know, being Asian and being in this Asian community and whatnot. Seriously, I was only 16 years old.
Yeah.
So it really didn't even dawn on me until then. But my mother did prepare me. You know, before I left for the pageant, she actually took me aside and she said, now don't cry when you don't win, because America is not ready for an Oriental Miss Teen USA. We used the word Oriental back then,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, of course.
And I was like, that's so stupid. I was like, nobody thinks like that anymore. This is 1985.
Okay, so
I had no idea, right?
But your mom was a little bit
in Hawaii.
But your mom was a little bit more aware.
She was definitely more aware than I was.
Okay.
And so when I came to Los Angeles to pursue this acting career right after high school, I didn't know even then, like, that there would be barriers, you know, being Asian.
Right.
I just always felt like, you know, it's what set me apart.
Yeah.
You know, that I wasn't going to have to be competing with the blonde hair, blue eyed Barbie doll looking girl. And that's sort of the idea that I went into the pageant with,
right.
You know, that I'm going to be so different. I am really going to be set apart because I look different.
So do you think that helped you? Do you think that gave you an advantage?
Did.
Oh, interesting.
I think that I was not apologetic for being Asian,
okay.
That I used it as a way to be noticed and to stand out.
Right.
And I think that attitude just in itself was very helpful.
Oh God, Kelly, that's such an interesting point, because it's almost as if you saw it as an advantage, not a disadvantage. Whereas someone like me, a kid who grew up in Ohio and felt like the other a lot and was made to feel inferior.
Right.
I had to develop my own confidence, which took a while, you know, because I was always treated that way. So therefore I had the opposite experience.
Uh-huh.
I felt like I had to prove myself as worthy of the mainstream and, like, you know, of the majority, rather than thinking that being Asian was exceptional or special.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Isn't that so funny?
That's really
interesting. The environment really makes a difference.
Oh, totally. Totally.
And were your parents immigrants?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, from Korea.
So
yep.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
So you're second. I don't know. How do they do it in Korea?
Koreans do it that way. So I'm considered second generation because grew up here. But yeah. So it was, you know, it was always a struggle that way for me, because I always was reminded I was Asian. I never didn't think I was. You know,
did you go to school with a lot of, or did you live around a lot of other Asians at all?
Zero.
What?
Zero.
Oh, wow.
My brother. I mean, seriously. So, you know, I grew up in Ohio in the 70s. And so there were hardly any Asians. And there was a sprinkling here and there, but in school, no.
Were you picked on a lot?
Oh, yeah. I was called the chink, Jap. Hong Ching Ching Chong, you know, all of it.
And you're now, like, dude, I'm Korean. They didn't even know what that is.
You know, even as a kid, you know, you don't know how to handle that, right? Nobody trains you on how to deal with racism. Now, you know, we're dealing with it now, obviously, because of COVID. And there's still this sort of shock sort of reaction that most people have, where they're like, did that just really happen? And so it's almost like people freeze when it happens because they can't believe it. So for me, I got it on a, not a consistent basis, but it, you know, it happened throughout my childhood. Let's put it that way.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
And your parents probably didn't know how to prepare you for it, because they never experienced it until just then.
No, nobody really. My brother had to deal with it, you know, as an Asian male. I think it was actually maybe even harder.
Yeah.
But you know what I do say now, Kelly, I look back and it made me so much stronger, because it made me very aware at a young age, of the truth of the world. Not that everyone is like this, but that this exists and I have to know how to deal with it, and I have to be stronger, you know, in dealing with it and grow more confident. of who right. I am. Now, that took a while because I had to get out of that situation and then be more exposed to Asians and, you know, kind of the idea of being Asian. But yeah, it was challenging.
So where did you get your first job in journalism then? Were you were out of Ohio,
yeah,
clearly.
I was out of
you
Ohio.
You probably left quite immediately.
I got an internship in Ohio for a summer, and then I got an internship in San Francisco where I was going to college.
Oh,
and that's
okay.
where that's led me to my first sort of, you know, little job in a San Francisco station as a production assistant. But because uh-huh. I was in the Bay Area, obviously, you know, I was more exposed to diversity, which certainly uh-huh. helped because it gave me the confidence knowing like, oh, someone like me actually can do this, you know,
right.
if I work hard and, you know, I pursue it. So that certainly helped. That environment helped me for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think just knowing that there are other people like you,
yes.
struggles, you know, having their struggles,
right.
really helps with self-confidence.
It does. It does.
And I think that's why it's so important right now with all of this bullying and attacking of Asians and people like yourself who are calling it out.
Yeah.
Who are really sort of the strength behind, you know, helping people to face it and not
right.
fear it.
And not fear it. Well, here's the thing. I have been calling this out from the very beginning because I recognize
yes.
it. I recognize it and it's so personal to me because I lived mm-hmm. through it. And I've been saying this on my show, all the xenophobia and the racism against Asians, it's as if I have PTSD from my childhood. Okay.
Right.
So it's bringing back not great memories for me. And so therefore I don't want other people to be going through this, especially kids, when I see kids
yeah.
being bullied. So it's my job. I feel like it's my duty as someone who lived through it to mm-hmm. call it out and try to do something to stop it because, you know, we can't, like you're saying, we can't just sit silently. We can't just ignore it and dismiss it thinking that, okay, I can't get involved.
It's going to go away.
No.
No.
Screw that.
Because even before COVID, Asian kids were the most bullied of any ethnicity.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
And so much to the point where we've had to do campaigns
yeah.
against bullying and helping Asian kids find the confidence and
right.
stand up for themselves.
Yeah.
You know, so this is not just a new thing that's come back.
No.
It's been around.
It
and
has.
It's just
and Kelly,
increased.
I mean, let me ask you this because you're in, you know, you're in Hollywood and you're in entertainment. What I find so fascinating and disappointing is that, speaking of bullying, it seems that Asians still can be the butt of everyone's jokes. They can still be openly made fun of in, you know, in movies and TV and even like, remember Oscar So White when, who was the host? Gosh, I'm completely forgetting the name.
The
comedian.
Chris Rock.
Was it Chris Rock? Yes.
Yeah.
It was Chris Rock and he made an Asian joke on stage. Openly. And so it just said to me, wow, you know, even at a time when we're trying to shed light on, you know, the discrimination in Hollywood, there
right.
was still
but
a joke
being made.
But
I think the reason why people thought that that was okay was because they were not cutting down Asians,
yeah.
but they were making them seem super, super smart.
Yeah, but it was a math joke, right? It was like an accounting joke.
Yeah, which yeah. is still
which is a stereotype.
That
it's
people
a stereotype.
Just don't understand.
Yeah.
Right.
But my point being, and that's one example, but it's just, I feel like Asians still are the group that can still be openly made fun of and it's okay to a certain extent.
Right.
Right. And I think that is starting to change, but I still see it. I still see that the bullying, whether it be overt or very subtle, that against Asians, for some reason, they can push the envelope a little bit more against, you know, Asian.
I think we just seem like we're less threatening.
Yeah. And we don't push back.
You know,
we don't push back.
Because we don't fight back.
Yeah.
You know, and Asian men, especially.
Yes.
Are emasculated.
Yes.
And, you know, of course, that goes way back, right? We know that
right.
goes way back to the Chinese Exclusion Act
yes.
and the Page Act and
yep.
not being able to bring their wives over
mm-hmm.
and, you know, just making Asian men seem asexual,
right?
You
right.
know,
and
I mean, so that's
yeah.
started way, way back over 100 years ago. Right. So Asian men are still fighting that.
Yeah. And then, you know, Asian and women have been exoticized and, you know, that kind of thing. So,
which
I take,
you know, responsibility for that as well. I realize that I was part of that problem, you know, but then again, I was just trying to get work.
I was just trying to make a living.
I was trying to find my place.
I commend you for even saying that, that you take some responsibility. That's actually pretty courageous of you to say that.
Well, I cannot ignore that.
I really admire you for saying that.
Well, things have evolved, right? Yeah. It's a different day and age. I have a new awareness now.
Right.
You know, I've even made Asian jokes that were inappropriate because I just didn't know better.
Right.
But now we know better, right?
Yeah.
Now we know better. Now we can do better. Now we can call things out, things that really are inappropriate. And sometimes we may get upset by things that maybe we should, like, overly upset by things we should only get a little bit upset about. But because we have to draw attention to it.
Yeah. Exactly.
I get that.
Yeah.
I get that now. But, you know, also growing up in Hawaii, we made fun of all ethnicities. You know, it was just sort of, and I grew up with a dad who was, I used to call him sort of like the Chinese Archie Bunker, because he just, you know, was prejudiced against everybody.
Oh, really?
You know, Chinese too.
Funny. Okay.
You know, he had names for everybody.
Yeah.
So, you know, I grew up in a different generation.
Yes.
And yes, you know, there was, you know, some things that I probably should not have said or done or whatever. But now we live in a information age.
Yeah.
Right. And we know better. We know, we can see firsthand how things hurt people.
Right.
You know,
it's called evolving. And, you know, we should always be evolving. But right now it seems like we're going backwards because of what's going on. Right. And that's scary. But but let me ask you this, Kelly, since you are talking about, you know, the past roles and, you know, the fact that you just had to work, you had to take these gigs. How have you seen, though, things change in Hollywood? Because, you know, I was talking to Adele Lim recently. And
oh, I love her so much.
Isn't she great?
She's
another badass.
Right?
Totally another badass. We should make a, like, Asian badass women's club. I think that's an amazing idea, actually. It's brilliant. Okay.
Right?
Anyway, so Adele and I were talking about the fact that, wow, isn't it funny how pre-COVID we were all on such a high, you know, because there was such great growing Asian representation. There was the Crazy Rich Asians and Fresh Off the Boat, The Farewell. Parasite had just swept the Oscars, you know, and then bam, this happens, right? And so I was wondering, like, from your perspective, you know, we really had made a lot of strides in Hollywood, right? And things had changed.
Right.
So tell me how you feel about that.
Well, it did definitely seem like the tides were turning. I mean, you know, when I first came to Los Angeles, there were not a lot of roles for Asian people, period.
Right.
This was over 30 years ago. But there were also not a lot of Asian actresses.
Yeah.
So there wasn't a lot of competition for me to have to, you know, it's, you know, there was me, Tia Carrera, Rosalind Chow was doing some work. You know, Ming-Na wasn't even on the scene. Lucy Liu was not even on the scene yet when I first arrived.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I mean, it was pretty bare. So, now there is so many more Asian actors and writers and producers and, you know, people behind the scenes who can make the content, make all of this stuff happen.
Right.
You know, before that, it was, you know, there was nobody. I mean, that's why CAPE started, right? The Coalition of Asian Pacific Islanders in Entertainment.
Right. Yep.
Because there were so few Asians in the entertainment industry, they really had to form this organization to find one another and help the Asian community, you know, behind the scenes, create the content. And so, yes, I am so glad to see that things are changing or were changing. And I think that in Hollywood, it still will be that way. We've just been put on hold, you know, because of this virus.
Yeah.
I think once things come back, I think Hollywood will still be a place for Asians to be able to excel and, you know, show up. But
so you don't think that this has been sidetracked or it's going to go backwards, right? I mean,
I don't think so, because the people who are doing it
are
not the people who control the entertainment industry.
Mm.
The people who are doing, you know, in the politics, on the streets, who are abusing Asian people, attacking Asian people, they are not people who are in power at all.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the people who are in politics are, but the people who are doing the attacking are not, they have no power, right? And this is why they're doing it.
And they're a minority. They are truly a minority,
but they
make a lot of noise. These people, they make a lot of noise. And so they get all the attention and that's what they want. Yeah.
And this is why we have to make noise.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
We have to be on that other side of the street.
Absolutely.
You know, doing the opposition, you know, protest because... Yep. Because we can't take this sitting down. We have to show people that this is happening. So when it was first starting, and I did a post on Twitter about people attacking Asian Americans or Asian people in the
around
U.S.
Around the world and around the world.
China virus, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some of the comments that I was getting was, I'm married to an Asian person and I don't see anybody attacking Asians, or, you know, I know an Asian person and there's, you know, nobody being attacked, because we're not calling it out.
Yeah.
You know, they don't see it. They think it's not happening.
Right.
But
right.
It's happening. It's happening. Maybe not in right outside your door.
Yeah.
But it is
happening a lot.
Happening.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And listen, Kelly, I mean, that's why I talk about this so often on the show and in posts and all that, because, you know, it's information is power, right? And so you can't blame people for not knowing about it if they're not getting the information. Right.
Right.
So it is our job, honestly, to vocalize and to inform. So even amongst my friends who are not Asian, I started bringing it up early on and they were like, really? That's happening?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I had no idea. And so then they started reading up on it and then they started spreading the word. And that's
right.
How it happens. Right.
If you start building allies.
Exactly. That's the only way to do it. That's the only way to do it. Yeah. Because
right.
You cannot blame.
If it's only Asian people yelling and screaming about it,
then
people are not going to take it as seriously.
No. Definitely.
Right?
Definitely.
So you definitely need to bring allies, and people of, you know, who are not Asian need to also join in.
Absolutely.
You know, even especially just like in the Black community.
Yes.
Right now where people are lacing up their tennis shoes to go on a run, protesting.
I did that.
Right.
Because,
oh, you did that.
Oh,
good
yeah.
You.
Because, you know, here's the lesson that we all need to learn, which is that we can't do it alone. Right. And communities of color have to come together and work together, because that is where the power is going to grow and the voices will become louder, because we all are experiencing this form of being treated like the other or racism or whatever it might be, you know, in one form or another. So to build that solidarity.
Yes.
Is
and
important.
Here's the thing, the evil comes in the form of racism and things of that sort, right?
Yeah.
But the unity, it's not Black against white, or, you know, all other races against white. That's not the war.
Yeah.
The war is good against evil.
Yes.
So everybody who is on the side of good and
kindness.
Being just a good person, a humanitarian, somebody who sees other people as human beings, we need to band together, not just minorities.
Yep.
It's good people need to band together against the evil people who are out there using racism and using that as their platform, you know, to bully and attack other races.
I mean, look, I think it was Nelson Mandela who said, you know, nobody is born racist. Nobody is born looking at the color of somebody's skin and making a determination about that person. Hatred and racism is learned.
Right.
So that's
absolutely.
So
I think there's a lot of people, like white people, who are not as eager to join this platform because they're thinking that they're being marginalized, right? Mm, yeah. All people are being attacked for being racist. But we have to also make sure that we don't exclude them.
Yes, you know, absolutely. Yes.
And so it has to be part of our, you know, our message that it's not everybody against white people.
Right.
It's, you know, that we have to just include, make sure that we don't exclude other people as well who are not part of those attacks.
Yeah. It's really just being basically trying to create a civilized society where it's about compassion and humanity and kindness. It seems so simple, but very difficult to achieve, you know, especially in our divisive era that we're living in right now. But speaking of speaking out, I have also talked about this on my show, which is that I've been disappointed. I think it's gotten a little bit better, but I have been disappointed in the lack of some folks not speaking out and choosing to stay silent. And I have said this before, I'll say it again. I think some very high profile people who have a very large platform, who have the ability to reach a lot of people, a broad community of people they could reach, they have chosen not to. What do you make of that? What do you think?
I kind of, you know, because being somebody who's in the public eye like this, I understand where that fear comes from.
Where does it come from? Tell me, explain to me where that comes from.
Because I know that as an actor, anytime I've spoken out politically, I have gotten a lot of pushback.
Yeah.
And you can see also the followers falling off, right? I think that there's just like this fear of being attacked online, and you know, trolls can get really rough.
Oh, totally. I have that too. Yep, I get that
too. You must find it in spades. I've been so fortunate. Like, I have such a great following. I every once in a while I'll get like some trolls, but it's never that bad. I have also made it a point not to talk politics in the sense of, like, I will support the Asian community, of course, but I have chosen not to talk about politics. Not because people are like, shut up, you know, you're an actor, nobody wants to hear your opinion, blah, 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 blah. Well, then you know what? Just stop following me then. But I've chosen not to do that because I want to be a voice of unity as opposed to divisiveness, right? Division. So I really try to not talk badly about, you know, Republicans and the right and things like that. Because I don't think it's helpful.
I get that. Yep.
But so maybe there's a fear of the backlash.
Yeah. I'm sure that's a big part of it. And I also think that there's probably a fear that it's going to affect their career somehow.
Maybe. But, you know, I think that there are so many people who are allies to this cause, the Asian cause, right? That there really shouldn't be a fear of that.
I'm not saying that it's justified.
Them,
I get it because it's such a, you know, there's so much anger and hatred going on. So I get why they're fearful. We're all fearful.
Right.
We are.
Right.
Right. But I do feel like, wow, you know, this is a moment in history, for the world, but for the Asian community, this is a pivotal moment. It really is.
Right.
If this moment doesn't move you and motivate you in some way, I don't know what would.
Right.
I really don't. And that's,
and maybe it's easier for us also because we don't have children to worry about. Right.
That's an interesting point. Yeah. Huh.
Because, you know, if people start you know, bullying, it's just us who gets attacked.
Okay.
Whereas maybe other people have children that they have to worry about their safety or their,
No, I get that, but
bullying
okay.
online.
All right. I'm going to be such a bitch right now. Some of these some of these folks I think I'm thinking of have no kids either. So there.
Okay. Okay. I'm just looking for possibilities. You know? Yeah.
See, you're sweeter than I am. So there you go.
I'm trying to give them the benefit of the doubt.
No, you know? And fair enough, Kelly. Honestly, I say this only because I want our community to really take this opportunity to empower ourselves. And I think especially younger generation, if they hear from those that they respect, and they get that inspiration, I think that really helps motivate and push the cause forward. Because look, you know, yeah, we're old, right? According to these people who say that.
I'll own it. Yeah.
Yeah. But you know, but so it's up to the younger people to carry this on, because this is going to be a legacy that's going to carry through for a while, just like Vincent Chin was in 1982. Right. And so this is the Vincent Chin moment, but actually probably bigger. So that's why I kind of, you know, wish that there would be a little bit more going on. But I am seeing now, though, there are more people speaking up. There are more events being planned. There are more organizations, you know, that are trying to take the lead. So that's good.
I mean, I've been doing several PSAs for different organizations to be cool to Asians. I tried to do a video for Watch the Hate, but I kept doing it over and over so much that my hands started getting rashy from like doing so much soap. I was like, okay, I gotta put this on hold until my hands can heal.
But
there's all these campaigns. There's another one coming out, an anti-bullying campaign that's been going around for a long time for young Asian Americans. Mm. I mean, just a lot of these PSAs that I've been, you know, recording and being a part of, as well as, you know, PSAs to help people in COVID, you know, who are, hungry and out of jobs and things like that. But it's just, it's really a time for people who are fortunate enough like us to have an audience, to have a platform, to bring awareness, to set examples of, you know, unity and compassion and, as well as strength, you know?
Oh yeah. I think that's important. I think that's really important to, this is also an opportunity, I think, to show the world, here in the United States, of course, but the world as well, that the stereotype of Asians, you know, is not correct. Right. So this, that's why I really do want people to become more courageous and more bold, because this is an opportunity for us to show that, no, we're not going to sit back. We can push back. We're going to fight back and we're going to speak up. So I hope that people do take on that. I don't know. I mean, you know, it's almost like we want to become superheroes to a certain extent in terms of really fighting the good fight.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we sort of have to, right? We have to don our capes and really, really go out there and call it out.
And call it out.
When it's, when we see it, when we, you know, and that's why the internet has been great that way.
Yeah.
You know, that we are able to document and show people that this is happening.
Right.
You know, there's so many people who really still are shocked that Asian people are getting called out, even though the president, you know, made that sort of comment about, you know, don't attack them. You know, they're really good people.
Right.
I wasn't convinced that it was really like heartfelt, but you know, who are we to tell him how to say anything?
It was scripted. It was scripted by somebody else. So that's what I'm just going to say. Exactly.
But you know, at least it's recognized. At least it's, you know, it's not being sort of swept under the rug and, you know, pretending it's not happening, because you cannot.
Yeah, no, listen,
the internet,
Kelly,
doesn't allow you.
He read
that statement, yes.
Because I think enough people spoke out against the rhetoric. And, you know, and it was being heard and it was loud. And so finally, his administration and whoever was advising him was saying, okay, Mr. President, you need to acknowledge this. And so
did he stop calling it the China virus after that, though?
He did. Stop calling it the Chinese virus.
Okay.
Yeah. So,
well, you know, kudos to him. We have to give him credit where credit is due.
Well, in
that sense.
Yes. No. And, at least his advisory staff and those who, you know, are telling him, listen, this is happening, so we need to change course. So my point being is that would not have happened if there wasn't a lot of protests and a lot of noise and a lot of complaints and people speaking up about it. That would have never happened.
Of course, the damage is done, right? Because it already gave license to people who had this, you know, this prejudice concept. Discrimination.
Those people are still going to feel this way. But the fact is that is evidence that if you speak up, if you push back, if you organize, and, you know, are bold and loud about it, then it will incite change. It will.
Right.
And that's why we have to keep going.
And I think you and I are of the same ilk where we are just naturally loud anyway.
Yeah, totally.
Naturally outspoken. Like, I cannot hold my tongue.
I know. And you know what's funny, though, Kelly? If you met me when I was a kid, oh my God, you would be like, no, that cannot be the same person. Oh my God, I was so quiet and so shy, did not speak in class. Every report card I would get when I was a kid was, she's a really good listener, because I never spoke.
Mine was always, she talks too much.
So you at least were consistent throughout your life. No, I was completely the opposite.
Was there like an inciting incident that made you just like come out?
Yeah. I think it was a transition that I made from, I went to boarding school for high school, and that was my choice. And it was an all girls boarding school in Connecticut. Okay.
Were you the only Asian?
Yes. In my class, there was maybe two other Asians that were in different classes. Yes.
And girls can get mean in a very different way.
They can, but I will tell you, something about an all-girls boarding school where, you know, it sounds very posh, but really the life at boarding school is, you know, I mean, you're under like the gun. You're under pressure. And there was a camaraderie, because we all knew we were there together without our families, without our parents. So it was really a sisterhood, and we kind of like thrived together. So it was do or die, though, because some girls would go home after the first year because they couldn't take it. I came out of my shell. It allowed me to come out of my shell and find my confidence, find my voice. And I'm telling you, in the 3 years that I was there, I completely changed as a person.
I have to say, because maybe from my pageant experience, I would have thought exactly the opposite.
Really?
That it wasn't a sisterhood as much as it was competition and cattiness. And that is so beautiful to hear.
Yeah. No, I mean, look, it existed, but very limited. I mean, I'm being totally truthful, especially as an Asian girl going to boarding school that was mostly white and, you know, sprinkling of a little diversity, but not much. But it was really interesting to see that these girls, some of them coming from very posh, wealthy families, you know, and others, you know, middle of the road, whatever. But it's as if we had the same bond. We were there to learn and become educated, whatever, but we also were there to learn how to be independent. And so I think that common, you know, denominator brought us together, and it really did change me.
It might have been also just your class or because or was it the school, do you think, that encouraged that sort of bonding?
I think the school had a lot to do with it. It had a long history. And I think me personally, I think I was so ready to come out of my shell. You know, I was this Korean American girl growing up in Ohio with very traditional parents. So, of course, I was your typical Asian kid. I had to play the piano and the cello and did ballet and gymnastics and, you know, this. I mean, everything, like everything. And so I kind of felt very restricted, you know, because I had this like very tight schedule of everything, and then also traditional parents. So there was a part of me that felt limited, right?
Uh-huh.
And so when I was able to kind of break free from that and then really challenge-
A liberation.
A little bit of a liberation, but also then challenge myself, okay, May, do you have what it takes? Do you have what it takes inside?
Were you, did you make the decision when you, before going in
yeah.
to this boarding school that you were going to recreate yourself?
No.
Or did that, no, it
no.
just happened organically.
Exactly. But there must have been something in me that was maybe subconscious. Why did I want to go? There must have been a reason why I wanted to go. It's not like my parents were sending me away at all. They didn't, no. they actually didn't want me to go. But I wanted to go. So there must have been something about the idea inside my head that I needed this change. I needed this freedom to discover myself, to find myself, right? So maybe I walked into the situation with that somewhere in my subconscious. And then once I got there, it allowed me to, yeah, blossom. I really, that's what I call it. I blossomed, I broke out of my shell, and all by senior year, I was like one of the coolest seniors. And I mean, it was just total transformation.
Were your parents like, who are you?
They kind of were, yeah. And then of course, went to college, and that's when I was like, I'm going to be a journalist. Before I thought I was going to be a doctor, of course, because you know, Asian.
Of course.
Science and math.
My mom knew that was not in my cards.
Oh my God. My parents were hoping and praying, but I mean, science and math, I couldn't do it to save my freaking life.
Oh, really?
Oh,
oh wow.
No, I still have a phobia of math. So then I had to be very honest with myself. Okay, May, what do you really actually like doing? And what do you see yourself doing? And that's when it was, journalism. It just came to me and then boom, that was end of story. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel sometimes like destiny just sort of happens, right?
I think so.
That all of this, you cannot plan in your life.
No.
You know, it just kind of falls together. And then all of a sudden you can look back and you go, that was my destiny.
Yeah.
That you know, was meant to happen.
One of my favorite lyrics is John Lennon's Beautiful Boy. And there's a line in it that says, life is what happens when you're busy making other plans.
Wow.
Isn't that a good one? And that's what happens.
I know that one. Okay.
Right? That's what happens. It's like you think you're going to set it this way and then boom, then something, your life starts happening. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's you know, it's good. It's good that you can, it's good to go into life like, you know, having plans and striving.
Yeah.
But then when life takes a turn, like a COVID virus happens.
Right. Right.
You know, it's like, you gotta be just like, okay with it. Like,
exactly.
This is the destiny. This is what's meant to happen.
Right.
I'm going to learn my lesson from it later.
Yeah.
But you know, let's see where this takes us.
I think that is the perfect example, Kelly, because I think this situation is allowing us to just stop. Or at least slow down and really assess, really do a self-assessment on, okay, you know, what is it that really I care about? What is it that really moves me, inspires me, you know? Because life has so many distractions and noise and, you know, obligations and all of this stuff where you just don't have the time to even ask yourself, you know, what do I want? You know, what do I care about? And I
mean, that's the number one thing, right?
Yeah.
I think that everyone is going through. That's like our common thread right now.
I hope. And I hope people do come out of this better or more clear-headed or more focused, you know?
Right. Having more compassion for one another.
And more compassion.
Right?
Yeah.
I think we were losing our connection to other human beings.
Yes, we were.
And this has forced us to connect, even electronically, but forced us to connect as humans more,
right?
You know, to stop, slow down, you know, think about the people that you love, think of who you want to call, who you haven't called, how many ex-boyfriends?
Kelly, can we talk about that? Can we talk about that for a second?
Yes.
Four.
Do it.
Four.
Isn't that, it's true, right? You want to start healing and not like reconnecting because you want to like start stuff again, but you just want to make sure that you tie up the loose ends.
Well, actually, Kelly.
And that you know, if there's a moment where you are going to be leaving this earth,
yeah,
you want to sort of have a clear conscience.
Yeah, that's right? True. But although two of them actually were trying to get back together.
Okay.
Yeah. Not going to happen, but yeah.
Okay. But isn't it nice to know?
You know, one of my girlfriends says, oh, honey, they always come back. They always want to come back.
Because they know a good thing, right?
Well, you snooze, you lose, man. You know, they had their chance, right? So, yeah. Now that we're talking about dating, so it's an interesting thing to be an older woman trying to date. Now, I know, is it okay if I ask you about, like, you're in a relationship?
I never talk about it.
Okay, I don't want to ask. I don't want to ask you questions
in
about
that
it.
Way. Yeah. Just because I like to have things private,
right.
And people are like always, you know, don't worry, not just you, but especially on Twitter and stuff like that, people are always asking people because I don't want to be like out there with my personal. There's always so much I can keep personal.
I think that's a good thing. Yeah.
I get a lot of, you know, flack about who I date and whether they're Asian or not,
right.
Or what religion they are. And that's nobody's business.
Yeah. Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah.
But that's interesting that they ask like about their ethnicity and all of that, because sometimes I think there's pressure to represent in every
right.
aspect of your life. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
For sure.
And you know, love doesn't care, right?
No, it shouldn't. It should be colorblind.
What face
you
have.
Totally.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
So it shouldn't make a difference.
Yeah.
You know, and it would be disingenuous for us to go out looking for only an Asian man to date. Right?
Just because we're supposed to. Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Now you've never been married, right?
I have never been married.
Me too.
I am too smart for that.
Yeah, me too.
Because we're smart, badass women.
But sometimes I think that's the problem with me. Maybe I'm just a little too badass. So it's just like, you know, the intimidation factor or whatever. I have no idea.
Do you want to get married?
You know, at this point, at this age, it doesn't matter, right? I mean, like,
right.
I think of it very pragmatically. I don't need to get married for financial reasons or having children, right?
Right.
So
same here.
So from a pragmatic point of view, no, it's not a necessity. Do I want a, you know, a strong partnership? You know, sure. I mean, you know, most people do, right?
Right.
I'm definitely not like an introvert who like always wants to be alone. But yeah, easier said than done, especially that's why I brought up the age thing and, you know, and then being in LA, it's challenging.
Yeah.
To date.
I was in a 12-year relationship about 5 years ago. And since then, I've mostly dated younger men.
Ooh, are you a cougar girl?
And I and not on purpose.
Okay.
It's, you know,
it just happens. Yeah. Well, first of all, you look younger than your age. So that, I mean,
I'm also really immature. So it really helps that I'm with younger guys who can put up with me.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Yeah.
I don't see the value in getting married.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not against marriage because there are some people who are really comfortable with marriage and all of that. But I feel like a wedding is a big waste of money.
Yes.
B, you're making a promise to, you know, everyone and God that you are going to be in this relationship forever until death.
Mm-hmm.
But you have no idea of what life is going to, give you.
Right.
I mean, it's for some people. Some people need the comfort of being in a marriage.
No, and I don't judge people either way.
It's just the opposite. I feel like it's such a trap. I'm like,
oh my God, how funny. Kelly, because your parents divorced, right?
Yes. My parents are divorced from early on. So I feel like maybe I'm sure that has a lot to do with
I was just going to ask you if that maybe had an effect on you.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, yeah.
because, you know, and I grew up with a single mom, even though she was in a relationship for a long time. Mm-hmm. She never got married, or my now stepfather never even lived with us until we moved out of the house.
Oh, wow.
So she waited until we were out of the house to finally marry this guy that she had been dating for like 15 years.
Wow.
So it's not as though I grew up with a stepfather.
Okay.
You know, I grew up with a single mom.
Yeah.
And so I see the strength in her, and I just felt like a guy would have to really add to my life for me to want to be able to give up all this freedom. Because like you said, you know, I don't need the money. I don't need the security. I don't need, you know, I don't want to have children.
Yeah.
You know, I just feel like there's not a lot of reason for me to want to get married.
Right, right.
You know, I don't need the security.
Being
in a relationship.
And I agree with you, Kelly. At this point in my life, if I were to be with somebody, it better be somebody who's going to enhance my life, right?
Yeah.
That stupid ass line from Jerry Maguire, "You complete me." I mean, that's such such bullshit, right? It's just like such a stupid ass line.
I know.
I mean, like, no, I don't need anyone to complete me. But I would love someone if they can enhance my life in some way together, that we're like better. Then that's great, mm-hmm. you know, but I'm
just somebody to bring joy, right?
Joy and fun,
and
humor.
Fun.
Yeah. All the things.
You got the rest.
You got the rest. And here's the thing. My girlfriends and I talk about this all the time, because I have a really solid group of single girlfriends who are all my age group.
Many
of whom have never been married either, which is really interesting. But, you know, we do talk about the fact that we're so rich when it comes to friendships. Like our girlfriends and our girlfriend friendships provide so much of that kind of different kind of intimacy, right? Not the physical, but it's like that emotional intimacy.
Yes.
That women
enjoy. Because there are
things
that you can share with your girlfriend that you can't even share with your partner.
Totally.
Like they just don't get it.
They don't get it. And they they don't want to get it, maybe, you know, to a certain extent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I feel like now we're in an age where we can define what family is.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So I am, you know, I don't mind sharing the fact that with this 12-year relationship that I had, mm-hmm. I have 3 embryos. At one point we thought maybe we were going to get married and have kids. It was he wanted to do this. He wanted to freeze embryos. He was actually looking in what it would take to clone our dog.
Oh,
remember
we
were talking about how awesome our dog was.
Oh,
he was looking online to see what it would take to clone the dog. It was $50,000 apparently.
You and Barbara Streisand.
Barbara Streisand has that kind of money, but not us. But through that process, he saw this whole thing about freezing embryos and stuff. And he asked if I would do this. I would consider doing this. And he even offered to pay. And, you know, with knowing how cheap he was, I was like, this must really mean a lot to him.
Wow.
And I thought to myself, you know, okay, I'm not the only one in this relationship.
Yeah.
I have to consider this other person if I think that this other person is going to be with me for the rest of my life.
Yep.
And so he said, look, I know you don't want to have kids, but at least this way we'll have the choice at some point if we decide that we're going to change our minds.
Okay.
So we made an agreement that I would, you know, keep the embryos because he can go off and have children with whoever he wants
if
you know, were to break up. And so now I have these 3 embryos.
Wow.
And I'm like, what am I going to do with them?
No, so what are you going to do?
I'm thinking of maybe finding a gay couple who's half, you know, who's Asian, Caucasian, or mixed somehow. And somebody, you know, a couple who is going to allow me to stay in the lives of these children, should they be able to, you know, grow as children, as like an auntie or a godmother or something, because, you know, we can define our own families now,
right?
There's technology. You know, if you're not bound by religion, you can sort of make your own utopia.
Right. It's a modern family.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Wow. That's so interesting, Kelly.
If you're not worried about society and how society is going to define you, you can make your own choices.
Right. That's very true. Yeah, that's God. That is so interesting. You're gonna have to keep me posted on that one.
I know, right?
That's so interesting.
I know. Yeah. I was actually going to have a meeting with some people, like a couple, about this. And then the whole COVID thing happened.
Oh, really?
Like, oh, I guess we're going to have to put that on hold.
Oh, my God. So it was recent where you were going to consider doing this.
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah. No, I've been looking. Yes.
Whoa.
I've been looking. And I even called the ex. You know, I was like, not that you have anything to do with this now, because it's not, but I just want to let you know that this is what I'm thinking. And, you know, and he was like,
was he okay?
At first he was like, well, what if, you know, cause now he's married, married. And he's like, I got to ask my wife. I was like, this is not her choice.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, well, what if this, you know, these children grow up and, you know, 18 years later come and look for their dad. I'm like, okay, either you're going to not be married anymore or you're going to have been married for over 20 years. Like, what are you worried about?
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, but it's, we can just sort of create, right? What we want in our lives.
Wow.
And not worry about, you know, other people are going to think.
Several years ago, I actually thought about doing it on my own. You know, having,
you want some embryos? Yeah.
I'm going to keep that stored away, you know, you never know. but I was, you know, cause I was thinking alternatively, like what would I want to do, or could I do it on my own? And I looked into it for a little while.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Growing up with a single mom, that was my worst nightmare.
I think that's what finally was like, God, man, you know, you need to seriously think about what that means.
Yes.
And I think that's why I finally decided not to.
There's a lot of single parents out there, moms and dads.
Yeah. Yes.
Who are doing it. And
they have no choice.
Don't know how.
I mean, seriously, single parents, I think they are true superheroes. They
absolutely
really are. Yeah.
Yes.
So,
my mom was absolutely amazing. And you know, she came from, like, you know, a deficit in the divorce, you know, in the holes, and just struggled. And so me winning this pageant, you know, back in the 80s, this prize package was enormous.
Yeah.
And I don't mind saying it was like 150,000 in cash and prizes. Yeah.
In the 80s.
In the 80s, 75,000 of it in cash.
Whoa.
So it just changed our lives.
Totally.
You know, before that, my mom and I were just struggling, and, you know, she was doing okay by that point, you know, much better. But
that's a windfall. A windfall, like, in a day.
Oh, my gosh.
Right.
Yes, absolutely.
Wow. Oh,
and
my God.
And to my mother's credit, she never took a dime.
She didn't?
Never took a dime of it.
Mm-mm. Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. She borrowed some so that we could buy a house, a condo actually to live in, but she paid every dime back.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Wow.
So she, you know, single moms, she just is like,
is she still
she's
alive?
Up there. Sorry?
Is she still alive?
She is.
She is.
She
is. Okay.
She just moved to Vegas from Hawaii
in
March.
What?
I was like, Vegas?
Oh my God.
What?
Wow.
I know.
Oh my God.
It was kind of, I felt so uprooted, you know, even though I haven't lived with her for over 30 years.
Yeah.
I kind of felt like, you know, she was like uprooting me from Hawaii and that it was like, I didn't have a place to stay there anymore. And, you know,
but now
it was
she's
like
closer.
My connection, but now she's closer.
Yeah.
So we've been driving out to see each other and, you know, she's made jokes like, for Mother's Day, why don't you just come drive out and wave? And then drive home.
I know. I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to do with my mom. And, you know, it's one of those things. It's like, she's high risk. So it's so nerve wracking to, like,
well, they all are, right?
They all are. And it's just, that's the part that's her. And she's your typical Asian mom who says things like, oh, I've lived a good life already. You know,
my mother says the same thing.
Oh, and now she's saying it's cute. But at the same time, I'm, oh, mom, don't say that. She's like, yeah, but this is also, she still speaks to me in Korean. So she's saying in Korean, this is also ridiculous. You know, I should be spending more time with my daughter before I die.
Oh,
I'm like, seriously, mom, you know, so I I know. But I know. I love my mom. She's the cutest. She's hilariously funny without even thinking she's funny. So, but
were you also raised by a single mom, or my parents were together,
unfortunately, and I won't get into it this time around. But unfortunately, my father was tragically killed by a 16-year-old driver back in 2011.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's a story I haven't talked about yet on the show. And I am trying to find the right time to actually talk about that story fully, because it's so complex in terms
of. But yeah, I get that. But even though you're an adult, when that happens, that kind of loss quickly must have changed you.
Completely.
And your relationship with your mom.
Completely. It completely changed the trajectory of my life. It changed the way I looked at life. It changed my relationship with my family. It changed friendships, you know, in terms of like how I now approach life. Because, you know, we all flippantly say, oh, I could die tomorrow. You know, we could, you just say that. Well, you know, my dad did die, you know, when he walked out the door, you know, without any kind of preparation. And so that kind of death and loss is so stunning and shocking and unexpected. So it really does impact you in a different way.
Losing a parent anyway.
Yeah.
You know, I lost my dad in 2003. And losing a parent, even if you're expecting it, he had lung cancer and emphysema, and so he was sick for a very long time. But it's still puts you in a different place.
Oh, no, completely. You know? It's a stunning loss when you lose a parent, right?
Losing someone so suddenly and so unexpectedly is, I can't imagine
what that does to you. As one friend said to me, he said, you know, your dad didn't die. He was taken. And when he said that, I'm like, yep, that's exactly what happened. So, yeah. So, you know, things like that change a person's, you know, from head to toe, inside out. I think, you know, I didn't want my father's death to be in vain. So I think that's why I found even more purpose in my life to try to do some good and try to, you know, put something good back out there in the world, you know, because he had worked so hard and, you know, made so many sacrifices for his family. So I feel like, well, you know, I don't have my own family, but I'm going to spread whatever I can in the world.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
you know, and as I said, you know, it's like we define our families now, right?
Yeah,
we can create our own, you know, what our own idea of family is.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so we might not be passing seeds on, well, I have embryos.
Yeah, you do.
I'm going to pass them on through somebody else. but I can't imagine, you know, doing that by myself.
Yeah.
Raising children by myself.
Right.
Well,
because
you've experienced it.
Yeah. You experienced it.
Well,
Kelly, God, I could speak to you for hours, but I seriously think we're going to become pals and we're going to totally hang out.
I hope so.
I'm serious. I'm dead serious. So,
after COVID, I'm coming over for coffee.
I'm telling you, you need to, let's go for a paddleboard or whatever, because it's beautiful down here.
I would love that.
I think that'd be cool. But before we go, tell me, is there anything, I know we're in the middle of COVID, so it's sort of a strange question, but is there anything that you're working on right now that we should look out for? What's going on?
You know, I have a movie that I shot, for Netflix, before all of this, back in October, November. And that should be actually coming out soon. It's a kids film.
Oh.
I play the mom.
There you go.
But, it's a kids film and it's kind of like Goonies, but set in Hawaii.
Oh, how
so
fun.
And it was shortly after my parents, you know, left Hawaii, right?
Yeah.
Where I was telling you, I was feeling so uprooted and not having that connection anymore, even though I have tons of friends, you know, I'm just being a baby about it. But it was so great to go home and spend all that time shooting this film and really like just connecting to the Aina, you know, the land again and being, you know, stepping foot there and also playing Hawaiian and getting to speak Hawaiian and use my pidgin English, which is like really my first language. And so, you know,
That's coming out
soon. Really looking forward to doing. Also, a Chinese woman who was directing, which you do not find a lot of. Yes, yeah. Jude Wang, who was an amazing, amazing woman. Also written by a woman who was half Asian, half Caucasian. I mean, just
oh, that's great.
Filled with, you know, love it. Beautiful, you know, Asian and Polynesian vibe.
That's awesome.
But a story that everyone will be able to relate to. So fun, so cute.
Can you tell us what it's called?
Oh, it's called Finding Ohana. Sorry.
Finding Ohana, and when is it coming out?
I don't know that they have an exact date yet, because I think with the virus, right, everything's kind of shifting around. You know, things are being pushed back, or you know, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
But we'll look out for it. Finding Ohana.
Yes. Finding Ohana.
Oh, yes. I love it. I love it. All right. Well,
you have been such a pleasure to watch and talk to.
Oh.
I could do this for hours.
I know. I'm serious. That's why I'm like, you know, whether you like it or not, we're going to be friends now. So we're totally going to hang out.
Absolutely.
So show or no show, it's just so fun to just talk to somebody who I think we're very similar. You know, we obviously are from the same generation. We've experienced similar things and, you know, we've had challenges and all that, but, and we've overcome them. So, I like connecting with a like-minded person like you.
Absolutely. Same here.
Yeah,
thank you so much for having me on your show.
Thank you so much, Kelly. And you take care, stay safe. And, I will hopefully see you soon face to face.
Yes.
Okay.
You too. Stay safe.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Well, that was so much fun. And now I have a new friend. Another badass Asian woman. I love it. So hope you guys enjoyed our conversation. I don't know. It almost sounded like just two girlfriends just chatting away. So it's maybe it felt like you were like a fly on the wall in a private area, or like we were having cocktails, you know, together and chatting about life and all sorts of things. So hope you guys had fun listening to that episode. Also hope you were inspired and motivated in terms of what we were talking about when it comes to the Asian American community and speaking out. So thank you for listening. Thank you for watching, and please keep supporting the show. Would love to get some reviews from you guys on iTunes or on Reddit or YouTube, whatever you want. And keep sending me messages telling me about what you like about the show or what you want to hear. Love getting that feedback from you. So do it via Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, whatever you choose. Okay. So everyone hang in there. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Until next time. Take care.